Welcome, and thank you for clicking play, you curious wrestling fan. On you, you probably saw Pro One Wrestling presents the Streak Undertaker WrestleMania matches one by one. My name is Alex Ramirez. Alongside me is my co-host Albert Cita. So this idea came upon me. We are in WrestleMania season here, and with very, very strong rumors saying that this is going to be Undertaker's last match at WrestleMania 33 against Roman Reigns.
And they've been saying that for quite some time.
But to me, it's more like now, like every time, it's like he's not feeling well.
The dead man doesn't stay dead.
Dead man is falling apart. So I figured, you know what? Let's literally go back from his very first match and like break down all of his WrestleMania matches. Not like as a technical aspect, but kind of just, you know, as fans and see, you know, which ones hold up, which ones don't, how maybe we could rank them later on at the end. So I think we're going to try and do this in part by part because he has like 24 total matches in WrestleMania. That'd be a marathon of a match. So I think this episode we're going to focus on his first six matches. So
try at least get through seven.
Yeah. So, we'll do that here. I guess we should just get a little background on ourselves. I'm 30 years old, lifelong wrestling fan. So his first few matches are like, I saw them on VHS, not live. I think the first real one in the moment I saw was WrestleMania 9 against Giant Gonzalez.
Mm-hmm.
So when we get to that, we'll cover that. But, I mean, for me, growing up, I think you'll probably see the later on podcasts that we do, because we're going to do a lot more, is I was a Bret Hart mark growing up. I'm still a Bret Hart mark. He was my guy growing up. It was there Bret Hart and Razor Ramon. Those were my two guys, one and two. But then Bret stayed and Razor left, turned Scott Hall, the whole, you know, NWO thing. But growing up for you.
It's funny because mine are similar, only it's Macho Man and Razor Ramon. But yeah, I've been a longtime fan. I think WrestleMania 9 might have been one of my first ones, too.
Yeah. We're the same age. Well, you're 30, I'm 30, so.
But was I ever a huge Undertaker fan? No.
Yeah. He was always never one of my top two, top three, but he was always there. I was always invested in his storylines growing up because he always had good storylines.
Yeah.
So, but I was never Man Undertaker. That's my guy right there.
You know who I like to compare him to? Scottie Pippen from the Bulls.
Okay.
MJ was everyone's favorite, right? But no one hated on Scottie Pippen, but I never really seen a Scottie Pippen fan.
Yeah,
just like I never really seen a Taker fan, to tell you the truth. I hear nothing but good stuff about Taker, but I never once seen or talked to a hardcore Taker fan.
That's a good
fan.
Point. It's like, you know, MJ won you the titles, but you know, without Scottie Pippen, you wouldn't have been there. Like, okay, Hogan got you to the big
ratings.
Stone Cold, The Rock. Hogan, Stone Cold, The Rock got you the big ratings, but Undertaker kind of, you know, was the backbone of everything.
He was the backbone of the team.
That's a good thing. But, I mean, this longevity is super respectful, so I think we just got to go. And as wrestling fans, we have to talk about this. So, I think the plan is to do you know, six matches an episode. I also plan on having some guests on here other than us two, because you want to hear us talk for forever.
Exactly.
It's going to be boring. So let's get started with WrestleMania 7 versus Jimmy Five Slicker, match number one, March 24th, 1991 in Los Angeles. It was main evented by Hulk Hogan and Sergeant Slaughter. This was actually, they're supposed to have this in the Coliseum, but lack of tickets, so they moved it to the LA Sports Arena where the Clippers played for
the
longest time.
And now I think LAFC.
Yeah,
is going to play there.
So now this is like, could be at the Forum, like the LA Coliseum, the LA Sports Arena. So it's kind of set at the state of times that wrestling was at this time. So, I mean, Jimmy Superfly Snuka, this is, I think, 4 months after Taker's debut. Mm-hmm. So this is his first WrestleMania match.
Still fresh.
I mean, looking back at this now, I think I was only with 4 or 5 when this was first came on. So when I first saw it, had to be like, I rented it on VHS or something. For the
It was definitely a look back.
Yeah. Looking back now with my educated eyes, because I'm a wrestling fan, I'm a smart mark. man, Snuka was doing the J-O-B here, wasn't he? Or is that just me?
He clearly was putting Undertaker over from the beginning of the match to the end of the match. He clearly was there to just make Undertaker shine. But he lost in a... No, I guess it was a squash match.
It was a squash for like.
I
to think of
it
now,
was very
like
short too.
Yeah, can you think of like in today's wrestling landscape, a squash match at WrestleMania?
That's crazy.
Like a veteran like Snuka, like it'd be like Braun Strowman going against like I want to say Chris Jericho. Maybe is that, you know? Or like, and it's a squash match like that where Jericho's overselling.
And it's funny because like I don't want to say squash match just because.
This is a squash match. I think
I know it was a one-sided.
If I'm wrong, like, please comment below.
It was a one-sided match.
Yeah.
Sure.
Which is a squash match.
Damn it.
I mean, little selling by Undertaker. I mean,
Snuka, he was still green.
So yeah, Snuka was flopping and flailing all around. He got a couple chops in, but Undertaker sold, you know, minimally, which he's supposed to do. He's supposed to be a dead character. The ending kind of came when Snuka was doing like a reversal, right? He tried to springboard off the,
obviously to the tombstone.
Yeah, he got caught, but then got a little bit of a mess up there, and Undertaker had to recatch him and do the tombstone piledriver. But I think if this is his character, this is way to go. I mean, I've seen worse WrestleMania matches, but I think I've seen better WrestleMania matches. But
I have to agree, but I still liked the match. I think I was entertained the whole time, you know, if it quote or unquote squash match.
Yeah.
I thought it was very entertaining. I thought Jimmy really, really sold for The Undertaker, and they had some pretty cool spots, I thought. I almost forgot he had that one where he would pick the guy up from outside the ring. And then do
a suplex?
A suplex.
Undertaker?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
kind of like a, like he'll even jump backwards.
Yeah.
I forgot that was in his arsenal, and it was cool to just see that again.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but this is clearly like you got Monsoon and Bobby Heenan putting over the Undertaker like crazy. Mm. The red mullet's awesome, isn't it?
Yeah.
Redheaded
ginger
mullet.
I always love ginger.
This guy's dead. Gingers have no souls anyways. You're the dead man. But this match comes pretty much it's a squash match. It's a squash match because it ends in a total of 4 minutes and 20 seconds, and Undertaker is 1-0. After that, he actually would win. After this WrestleMania match, he would go on to short feud with Undertaker. I mean, with the Ultimate Warrior, Undertaker would, and I think he would lose like a body bag match. And but then somehow
put him in a body bag.
But then he would win the world title later that year from Hulk Hogan in that Survivor Series with help from Ric Flair. So he actually would win his title not that long after it. So I think interesting match.
Was it one of my favorites? No, but I thought it was a solid match. Yeah. I liked it.
WrestleMania 7 was a strange card. Yeah, if looking back on it, but I think
that WrestleMania was very
to me that whole WrestleMania match is the whole card is just Macho Man versus Warrior, and then everything else is
just kind of an awkward booking.
Yeah, but I mean, yeah. So let's go to WrestleMania 8 the next year, Jake the Snake Roberts, April 5th, 1992, at the Hoosier Dome. This is one of the big arenas they had. Taker's actually working babyface here.
Yeah,
they do a little nice little package. Jake the Snake Roberts jumps Paul Bearer. And the, I guess, was it called the, I forgot what it was called, but the, you know, Piper's Pit before Paul Bearer, the funeral home or something like that.
Yeah, everyone had their own little.
Yeah, and he kind of, it was actually really cool, the buildup to it. He trapped Undertaker's arm in the casket, or his hand, kind of squashed it in there, locked it, so he couldn't move. He actually did a DDT to Paul Bearer, and then hit Taker a couple times with the chair. And Undertaker getting no sold, but hey, he's a dead man.
He's a dead man that couldn't get hurt.
But Jake the Snake Roberts, man, just, as a heel, one of the best heels I think ever.
Yeah, for sure. This is one of the better matches too. I think this one was better than the Snuka one.
Yeah.
The only thing was we didn't get the prime Jake the Snake. That's the only thing I kind of like. I kind of felt flat to me because obviously if you look at some of Jake the Snake's or when he's more in shape.
Yeah.
He has way better matches. But with that said, I think he's still. He's still putting on a good match, but I just couldn't eat up that angle. I don't know. Maybe just because looking in the future when it comes to like those type of matches, they're just more well put together. This one seemed a little bit too cartoonish to me.
Well, this one seemed actually a little bit the quiet, almost the exact opposite of his match with Snuka.
Mm.
So it was Jake the Snake who came up with a bunch of offense. I don't think Undertaker got any offense at all until like maybe halfway through the match. But he was kind of selling. He was kind of walking around wobbly. This is a good. If this would have been Undertaker's first wrestling match, I think it would have been a lot better than the Snuka match because he survived two DDTs. And this is at a time when if Jake hits you with that DDT,
you're supposed to go to sleep.
It's done. You're not getting up. You're done. This isn't Dirty Deeds by Dean Ambrose here. He survived two DDTs, and I actually like the finish where it almost like Jake the Snake Roberts caused himself the match.
Yeah,
because he went out and beat up Paul Bearer for some reason and got caught and did the tombstone on the outside, which would kill a normal man. But for Jake the Snake Roberts, he just out for the three count.
And there's actually a pretty big buildup to this match. I remember this was actually one of the bigger storylines for Undertaker since he made his debut.
Yeah.
And I thought it was a pretty good, it was a good enemy and a good person to go against each other. It almost felt right.
Yeah, because
Jake the Snake and Undertaker.
If there's one person who's a little more eviler than a man called the Undertaker, it's Jake the Snake Roberts, especially because of his reputation outside of the ring and, you know, inside now. Okay, this guy is cold-blooded. He has no problem. The metaphors are great. This Jake the Snake Roberts has no problem staring death in the face. You know, as you know, metaphorically, as in the Undertaker, he actually snuck behind death and stabbed it in the back. You know, metaphorically, it did cost him. But I mean,
and also we get a rare glimpse of Jake the Snake with white trunks. Which
is cool.
That I remember that threw me like off right off the bat. Yeah. I was like, whoa, I forgot he has white trunks.
I think he's coming off of a pretty long face run for Jake the Snake Roberts, and obviously Undertaker just turned. From being a heel. So, and if you ask anybody, I think Jake always preferred working as a heel, he said, which is, I mean, this guy's a natural. I mean, he's just super charismatic as a heel, just the way he talked and everything. And for Undertaker, be interesting as being a face here, because the man is so early on. This is way before the whole cool heel type of thing, but he could be like the cool type
considered,
of heel,
considered,
right?
Yeah, cool heel.
I mean, there was like LOD before that who were just... big dudes.
I mean, he still didn't do the traditional heel stuff, but
I mean, like I said, I think this was a match where Undertaker won. He did little selling, but I don't think it hurt Jake either.
No, especially the way it ended. Jake being so smart, what a clever ending that was.
I'm not gonna get beat by a regular tombstone. Yeah. I want a tombstone on the floor,
exactly.
Then to beat me, then get Roman. So that's it for WrestleMania 8.
I just didn't like the angle of the thing. It was just too gimmicky. At some point,
I guess. If you didn't like this one, then you're gonna hate WrestleMania 9. Go ahead and bring that up into your to your laptop or your iPad there. But Harvey Whippleman, who was managing the Giant Gonzalez here, who was Undertaker's WrestleMania 9 opponent, April 4th, 1993, at Caesar's Palace in the Coliseum. He was recently on Talk Is Jericho. Chris Jericho's a great podcast, and said that Undertaker still brings up Giant Gonzalez, like, to, you know.
Oh, wow. Like, as an example?
Yeah, so, like, if they want him to say, hey, guys, I'm not doing this. Oh, come on, Taker. Hey, you put me up against Giant Gonzalez. Remember that. So, as a kind of a guilt trip type of thing. So, that should show you how horrible this match was.
No. I remember this was one of the ones that I had to kind of skim through.
Now, right?
Yeah. Now, I kind of remember Giant Gonzalez, but I don't really remember him wrestling.
Yeah.
But I knew he wasn't known for his wrestling. Obviously, it was his gimmick. Such a horrible match.
Yeah.
It was such a horrible match. I always cringe when two big guys are booked together.
Oh, yeah.
Because I always think that that's not a good booking. I mean, you get the whole, I'm stronger, no, I'm stronger.
Yeah.
No, look, I'm strong. And like,
they do the run off and hit each other's chest.
Yeah. It just doesn't work for me, and this match was horrendous.
So I was 7 years old.
It was the biggest stinker I've seen.
So the good thing about like a lot of podcasts, wrestling podcasts today, is a lot of them are like, you know, guys are in the older now, so a lot of Captain Hindsights, where they go back, oh, this is just horrible booking, blah blah, which you're kind of doing here. But I kind of like take me back to when I was 7 years old, bro. I was like, I was into this, bro. I was all into it. 7 years old. This Giant Gonzalez said, yeah, like, I knew his suit was dumb back then. Yeah. Like, man, like, this guy's huge. I mean, Undertaker was unstoppable then. I mean, I was into it. I was like, what's going to happen? As a seven-year-old. And no comments, oh, what an idiot. I was 7 years old, bro.
That's true. On paper, these matches always look entertaining.
Yeah.
I mean, like, if you see a photo of Gonzalez as a kid, Giant Gonzalez, and you see a picture of Undertaker, you're like, dude, they're going to kill each other.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I guess, I guess I didn't think about it when I first originally saw it.
Yeah.
Because obviously we rewatched these, and I was just cringing the whole time. And rewatched it
now, you see how hard Undertaker's working.
Yeah.
I mean, I think this is probably one of the first times you got to see what a great worker he was in WWE. I mean, because if you look back and see his WCW stuff, the guy's super agile, super athletic, he could work. Yeah. But he never really had to in WWE because...
And Giant Gonzalez had one of the shortest runs, right?
Yeah, he came from WCW, and then he was gone. He was gone after this. But I think it was in Bret Hart's book, too. He said about how working with Undertaker, like, that he was super underrated because he had the whole Frankenstein gimmick.
Yeah.
Where he wasn't supposed to sell. Yeah, I'm the dead man. How can you hit the dead man? But, like, when you see Undertaker go, he can go.
Mm.
He could definitely go. I think it wasn't until, like, recently we got to see, okay, this guy, can actually work when he's allowed to work the long, you know, the long matches here and there. But man, this match was like a labor. You could tell.
Yeah. Such a labor. For sure. And it's funny because now we're starting to see the evolution of Undertaker in this one. His hair's getting a little bit darker.
Yeah, yeah. His hair's getting darker, longer. But, the ball's gone.
I did not like this match. A lot of punches. A lot of I'm stronger.
Yeah. But it got to the point too where Undertaker was like, okay, we need another monster to work with. Like we had the Kamala and stuff like that, and we just need a monster. We, you know, Godzilla needs his Mothra type of thing. So who's Undertaker being Godzilla and then Mothra being the Giant Gonzalez? So I mean, but this match was pretty rough. I mean, they went outside for a little bit, and it ends with Gonzalez gets hard movement, throws chloroform and just kind of makes Undertaker go to sleep, and it's a DQ. But what my favorite part is it's Bobby the Brain Heenan, Jerry Lawler, Jim Ross, and then Macho Man Randy Savage on commentary, and they're just overselling the crap out of the what's head. That smell? Oh God, it smells like chloroform. Even though the wind's probably blowing the opposite direction, because they're outdoors, it's like, oh God, I can smell it from here. Oh God, it's chloroform. It's chloroform. And of course, Undertaker goes down, but doesn't stay down for long.
You know what's funny? It's a perfect ending to the type of match they had. I'm not gonna lie to you.
Yeah. So technically,
if it's that horrible, might as well have the dumbest ending you can think of.
Yeah, and actually, the entrance is pretty cool. Came on the carriage, being kind of a super buff guy, and like the vulture on it. But I mean, it is what it is. Giant Gonzalez. I mean, yeah, people look back at probably one of the worst matches ever. But hey, they put it on. As a kid, I bought it.
I remember Giant Gonzalez. I really don't remember that match, though. I really don't until I had to rewatch it.
So I think we're halfway through now. Let's take a small break and come back and talk about WrestleMania matches 9, 11, 12, and 13, where he won the championship. So don't go anywhere. All right, welcome back. Let's continue this WrestleMania 11 versus King Kong Bunny, April 2nd, 1995. This is the one that was main evented by Lawrence Taylor versus Bam Bam Bigelow. Ugh. Main evented.
What a horrible WrestleMania.
Main evented, by the way.
Horrible WrestleMania.
A gimmick match. Always kirks me when they say, oh, the belt's got to go on last. A lot of times, the belt's never got on last. So, anyways, is it Triple H always, belt's got to go on last, bro? The Rock versus Hogan? No. Belt's got to go on last. I got to beat Jericho last. Anyways, we'll have a Triple H episode later and you can hear all that. But this match is a super gimmicky. WrestleMania 11, King Kong Bundy. So gimmicky that the referee was an umpire. MLB umpire Larry Young, and I guess the storyline was, I don't remember the story.
I totally forgot that.
I guess what it was, like, is they're on strike that year.
Okay.
So like, hey, I'm out of work, umpire. Come referee for the WWE, bro. We got you.
And then you also got the Million Dollar Man. on King Kong Bundy's corner.
So you got the I guess this was a match for his giant urn, that big old with the flashlight with the big old light coming out. So that's what the whole. DiBiase, who was managing Bundy, who's part of the Million Dollar Club or whatever, I forgot what they were called, or Team Money, or is that Mayweather? I don't know, but stole
the money team.
They stole the giant urn from the Undertaker, and that's kind of this whole match was, but this match was pretty brutal. It was so bad that they actually had a promo in the middle of it.
Oh,
so I guess the whole story was, if you guys remember, the Godfather was before that was Kama, the Extreme Fighting Machine. He comes down and steals. So I think Paul Bearer steals the urn back from DiBiase, and then DiBiase calls out Kama to come get it from the Undertaker. And then as he's running down the ramp down the to the entrance, Jim Ross stops Kama and they cut a promo on it in the middle of the match. So they really cut a promo. And he said, "Oh, I'm gonna melt the urn down to make it a necklace." And he actually did come out the necklace the next day. So
I don't know if it was Bret Hart that said it, but whenever you have the managers coming out way too much or like interacting in the match, you know it's a horrible match.
Yeah, this is one of them.
You know what? I really don't know which one was worse. This one or the other Giant Gonzaga one? Because this one too was. And this one was longer. Is what irritated me. this one was longer. So yeah. I was like, man, I can't believe I gotta watch the whole thing.
I believe it took him a total of 6 minutes, 36 seconds to defeat King Kong Bundy. And
how long was the Giant Gonzaga match? Because I thought that one was...
No, Giant Gonzalez was 7 minutes, 30 seconds.
Wow. I think that's just to show you how bad this match is. I thought this one was longer than
I think the last minute of that match was just him kind of on the floor over his face. But... it was interesting enough where like it's tons of gimmicks. It's like
opens the urn.
In the first 5 minutes, he's already outside. It's more about the urn than anything else. the match finishes when Undertaker, I think, he does a body slam, then a running clothesline that he always does.
Yeah.
And that's not because he couldn't get up. He couldn't get.
There's no way he's going to tombstone King Kong Bundy.
And this is before the chokeslam, I think, so, too. I mean, the chokeslam would have been kind of cool, but he didn't have.
Well, he did a couple of chokeslam setups.
Yeah.
But maybe that wasn't.
Yes, you haven't seen the card. Here comes Kama.
Yeah.
He steals it.
What a beautiful haircut, by the way.
The Extreme Fighting Machine Kama. Actually, MMA before MMA was even popular.
Yeah. So, they always sprinkle a little bit of stuff like that. You look back, you're like, hey.
This is in 95, so right about UFC. I think
UFC 96-ish.
Or 94 was it. But I mean, 94? Like UFC 1, I think, was around that time. So I think if you guys are watching along, Kama basically he comes down, and then he's already gut-kitted Paul Bearer, and they take the urn, and he literally runs down back to the backstage, and he stopped, and they cut a promo in the middle of the match. Can you imagine a person cutting a promo in the middle of a WrestleMania match?
At a WrestleMania. Come on, guys.
So
were they thinking?
Yeah, super, super gimmicky match. And
one thing to note, though, we now are starting to see Undertaker in his traditional purple.
Yes, this is the first time in purple. I think he missed WrestleMania 10. He took some time off and came back and worked like a dog till for a very long time. So that's it, WrestleMania.
Even in
11.
The promo, they have the green light on them. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
They cut a promo, a comma. So that's it for WrestleMania 11. Let's go on to the next year, March 31st, 1996, WrestleMania 12 against Diesel in Anaheim, California. Now, this WrestleMania is near and dear to my heart because of the Iron Man match where Shawn Michaels' boyhood dream came true, whatever. I don't know. This is Diesel on his way out. I think this is one of the last jobs Diesel did.
We're almost at the height of what I thought wrestling got to.
We're going to get there, actually. We're on the roller coaster. We're actually going up. So, to date, this is his longest match to date.
Oh, really?
To this point, this match lasted 16 minutes, 46 seconds.
I know towards the end it kind of lingered.
Yeah.
But I thought it was good pacing. But yeah, I guess the last like 4 or 5 minutes was kind of a stretch.
So like before this, all of the other matches lasted not even 10 minutes. So this is like 96. Hey, man, we need you to go long probably because they had the Iron Man match. Mm-hmm. But what does it really? So like, he got over almost 20 minutes here. But they did him and Diesel, Kevin Nash, kind of frantic pace in the beginning. I was like, man, they're both leaving their feet. I think he was leaving his feet left and right.
Yeah.
Some good selling from him. And then the last maybe 7 minutes, they were just kind of dragged till it just slowed down, man. The finish kind of came out of nowhere. Like, he just picked him up for a tombstone, and that was it. Like, randomly. Wasn't built up or anything like that.
Yeah, well, maybe it has a lot to do with that pacing that they set. Yeah. I really enjoyed this match. One thing that I would give them credit, again, when you usually book two big guys, you don't like I was saying earlier, they don't come out there. This one came out actually really well, but I think it had more to do with the fact that Diesel kind of took a charge of this match.
Yeah.
Rather than I feel the Undertaker really carried the other people, like King Kong. But he almost like he had to take the lead.
And this is the first time where
I think
he
was able to relax and let
they
Diesel,
can work together.
Yeah, exactly.
Almost.
Yeah. And I thought I thought it was a good match. I agree. The last like 4 minutes kind of dragged a little bit. But honestly, this is a very big turning point in the Undertaker because we're really starting to see
he can go.
Yeah,
he can go. And honestly, I want to point out Diesel's heel work was really good. This cocky heel, and he looked great. His upper body was super defined. Like, this guy's leaving for WCW, man. Mm-hmm. You can tell, like, Vince was like, man, I can't believe I'm losing this guy here. But man, his heel work was great. His cocky
and you know what
heel.
Made it even more awesome? We're losing the gimmicks at this point.
Yeah, no longer heel. But man, brushing his hair back. He's, come on, you people love me. You know you love me. I'm gonna beat this guy. But 16. To me, so far, this was his best WrestleMania match.
Yeah, I would have to agree.
Yeah, and then if we go to the next year, WrestleMania 13, finally gets his shot against Psycho Sid. He's gonna challenge for WWE World Championship, March 23rd, 1997, in Chicago. If you read all the rumor stuff, this was supposed to be a rematch between Shawn Michaels and Bret Hart, but
we know what happened.
Shawn Michaels lost his smile. And
is that the way you're now?
Yeah. So this is Undertaker's main event, his first main event for WrestleMania. I think his first shot at a title in a long time. Challenge Psycho Sid. To me, this had just as much gimmicks as his King Kong Bundy match. Because before the match even started, Bret Hart comes out and cuts a promo on all three of them. Because Shawn Michaels is doing color commentary, or guest, it's Jim Ross, JR, and Vince McMahon. And then Michaels does commentary for the main event. Bret Hart comes out of nowhere, fresh off of whipping Stone Cold's butt in the card, and cuts a promo where he sounds like a little punk. Like, he's all, I mean, he dishes Shawn Michaels. He calls him, you know, he's like, "You little pussyfoot injury," because he's like,
yeah.
"You lost your smile," and blah blah blah. He says, "My Undertaker, you like hit me on the head, so we're not friends anymore." And Sid, "I'm gonna beat you up too." And then Sid literally, I think, punches Bret Hart and gives him a power bomb and kicks him out.
Yeah,
and cuts a promo on Bret Hart saying, "Get out of here, crybaby." But the thing is, I think Sid's supposed to be the heel here, but he cuts a babyface promo on Bret Hart. So you had the crowd kind of cheering for him. And this is a very weird setup. And the Undertaker jumps Sid after that. So it's like, that's a heel move by Undertaker. So I was really confused watching this.
That's the thing I didn't like about it either, how safe they were keeping Sid. I want to call him Sid Justice for some reason.
Psycho Sid.
It almost felt like they're really, really keeping him safe.
Yeah.
Like, everything he did was, like, even the fact that Bret Hart had to intervene. Yeah. The fact that Undertaker bring him up at the end. It's kind of like, I don't know. It felt like Roman Reigns. I'm not going to lie to you. It felt like a Roman
Reigns. Sid was a man, man.
Roman Reigns match.
He was on top of the world. He was the king of the world, man.
But, yeah, this was...
Or the master and ruler of the world, I should say.
This is down there with the King Kong Bundy match. Yeah. I did not like it at all. It was one of the ones I really did not want to watch.
Also, before the match even started, too, JR actually mentions, like, Undertaker's actually undefeated at WrestleMania, which is kind
of one of the first mentions of it.
And also, too, looking back at it now, Undertaker wearing the all gray, is that kind of a dead giveaway that he's going to win the title that night?
How's that did a giveaway?
Well, because he was wearing purple up to then. Purple, and before that, he actually was wearing his all black attire.
Oh, because we're switching him?
Yeah, now he's wearing his all old school, all gray type of thing. Like the gray boots, the gray gloves. Is that kind of a dead giveaway? Like, hey, I'm going back a little bit. Like,
maybe I'm just not as smart as you.
That's what I thought. I was like, well, that's kind of weird.
That clearly went over my head. And now that you say it, though, it is weird that they established his purple thing, and they switched him back to gray.
Yeah, and he was actually wearing like all black before that, and then he just wore
and his
gray
hair is a little bit more red.
Red, there. I'm not gonna dye. I'm gonna be a little ginger. I mean, I've come out the mullet this time, old school. But yeah, I remember watching it. Like I said, I was a big Bret Hart mark, and just to come out and then Bret Hart actually interfered.
But they
at the
didn't
end
need to, that. That's the irritating part. To
and
me.
Then Bret Hart comes, interferes again. Yeah, that's Undertaker. It
feels like it's the only way to justify it's like that's what makes me mad. Like the only way Sid lost was because of Bret Hart, which is like okay. Like, it's like a whole Roman Reigns thing. It's like, dude, just lose, bro. Like it's Undertaker at this point. We know who he is. It's not like it's his first couple years. He's already almost a veteran at this point.
It's kind of shit. At that time, Undertaker didn't need any interference to win at all.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't know. I didn't like this match at all. It's down there with King Kong Bundy.
And what kind of sucks, and this is like his first like real shining moment. Yeah. Like this, okay.
Well, this is his WrestleMania, essentially.
You've been here for almost like 10 years now. I mean, everybody's left. Hall's left. Nash is left. I mean, we're losing here. This is 97. I think NWO is like, you know, almost at its height. Bret Hart's kind of teetering. I'm going to leave. I might not leave. Hey, man, you're the man, Undertaker. We're going to reward you for sticking around. Shawn Michaels lost his smile. He's leaving us. He's kind of, you know, one foot in, one foot out. And they kind of did all this stuff just to...
But see, if he would have done it clean, how much bigger would that match would have been?
I think it would have been great. I think it would have been great. But that's it for this episode, part one. We got six more matches coming up next. So if you let... comment, let us know we're right, we're wrong, what you guys thought. Out of the six, rank them. Let me know which one your favorite
are. We love them
are.
Trolls, so go ahead.
So let's bust a Dave Meltzer here. Combine all his first six matches out of 5 stars.
It's,
what do you give him? His WrestleMania career so far.
I'll rank all of them all in a package?
Like a package. Like his WrestleMania resume so far.
It's a 2.5.
2.5?
I think other than that Diesel match, I can't give him past 3 stars.
Yeah, I'm right at 3 stars.
Yeah, 2.5. Right? I'll do 2.5.
It's crazy how much it picks up a little bit later on. Mm-hmm. So, but we'll get to
that.
Wait till we get to the second half. Or the later end of his career. But yeah, interesting. So that's it. Yeah, let us know what you guys think. We got more of these coming. So yeah, we'll be on Twitter and Instagram, all that stuff. So let us know what you guys think. Again, my name's Alex Ramirez, Albert Cita. Thank you for listening.
You are now listening to Afro Mighty Radio.